Geodesy. So what it is that everybody is so eager to know about? What does it do? What does it apply? Or more importantly, why we need geodesy? Today we'll look at geodesy from a non-scientific point of view, without any jargon, without any big words. As we all know, Earth is a spherical object. It looks nice, round blue marble in the Google map. But believe me, it is not. We have almost 9 km high mountain and 12 km deep ocean. And it is a jagged rock at the best, bulging slightly at the equator. Cartographers from all over the world want to represent their area on a 2D flat piece of paper. Suppose I give you a big ball and tell you to make it perfectly flat like a map on a paper. You will have to cut it, pull it, stomp on it, but it will never be flat. But if you cut it into very small pieces, you might just make a small section flat. Distortion is the biggest hurdle that worries the cartographer. So the cartographers came up with many mathematical models. Some of the models are for the entire Earth, or some for the local region. Remember, all these models are best fit for the local region or for the entire Earth. Remember the word best fit. It will have distortion, but it will be the best fit for their region. Also remember that one region's best fit model is not going to best fit for other regions. So almost every country have developed their own best fit models for their own regions. And that, my friend, is geodesy. What? No, I'm not done yet. I'll now tell you what are the main differences in these models. So in layman's term, geodesy is the study of Earth and mathematical model by which we want to represent our local region, our continent, or the whole Earth on a flat piece of paper. But there is a very important component there, and that is called projection. We'll discuss about projection in a few minutes. Let us first understand the geodesy and how we define it. In my previous video, we discussed about latitude and longitude is being measured from the center of the Earth. So the center of the Earth is the origin for all latitude, longitude, as well as geodesy. But there is a twist. The position of the center of the Earth varies greatly from one mathematical model to another when they define geodesy. So where is center of the Earth? How do you even define where the center of the Earth is going to be? The so-called geodesists and cartographers define the center of the Earth by the measurement of two distances. Mind it, they're all mathematical. The first distance is from the center of the Earth to the equator, and this is called semi-major axis. The distance from center of the Earth to the pole is significantly less, and this is called semi-minor axis. So the main parameters are the distances of semi-major axis and semi-minor axis. In geodesy, a reference ellipsoid is a mathematically defined surface. Ellipsoid comes from the word ellipse, which is a generalization of a circle. But Earth is not circular. It is ellipsoidal. Scientists and cartographers have developed many different ellipsoidal models of the Earth, and the most well-known of them is WGS-84, or World Geodetic System 1984. So in layman's term, ellipsoidal models are primarily used to measure distances across the surface of the Earth. Ellipsoids are also used to measure the height above the ellipsoidal surface. Now you might have also heard about geoid. Geoids are also a vertical datum. Geoids are depiction of Earth's actual surface, or more precisely, the mean sea level. Both ellipsoid and geoids are vertical datums. Vertical datums are a reference plane from where the heights can be measured. Now, vertical datums are a whole new chapter, but you know what? They all are part of geodesy. Let us now see some of the major world geodesies and how they define the shape of the Earth in terms of semi-major axis and semi-minor axis. And now that we have defined the shape of the Earth, we now need to print it on a flat piece of paper. And here comes projection. You might have already experienced the projection in a big theater hall. A tiny film is being projected on a big screen. There are three main components in a projection. First, the object that we want to project on a screen or a flat piece of paper. The second one is the light source, or more precisely, the position of the light source with reference to the object that we want to project. And thirdly, the placement of the screen or the paper on which we want to project our object. There are hundreds of different ways we can arrange them together to better represent our region on a flat piece of paper. The key here is to minimize the distortion. The smaller the area we project on a piece of paper, the more accuracy we can achieve. Let's look at some of the popular projections and where they work and where they don't. First is a planar projection, where a sheet of paper is kept on the globe surface. Now, depending on the placement of light sources, this type of projection has three categories. First is mnemonic projection, second is stereographic projection, and third is orthographic projection. These projections can be varied not only by the position of the light sources, but also by the placement of the sheet of paper. Next, we take a cone and put it on the polar region. In this projection, the meridians will be the semicircle like the ribs of a fan. There are quite a few variations of this projection. The most notable is the Lambert conical projection. Next is a cylindrical map projection. A cylinder wraps around the globe. Depending on the projection area and placement of the cylinder, this projection is divided into three parts: cylindrical equal area projection, Gauss stereographic projection, and thirdly, or most popularly, the Mercator projection. Transverse Mercator is similar to Mercator, but the cylinder here touches the meridians instead of the equator. Here are some of the examples of cylindrical projection. And yes, Google Map also uses Mercator projection. And that, my friend, is Geodesy 101 in a nutshell. Remember, the mathematical models are being upgraded constantly, and you should study geodesy more in depth if you want to know more. I hope this short introduction will get you started in your journey. Did I earn your subscription today? Let me know in the comments below. And don't forget to give this video a like if you learned something today. I'll be back soon with more videos like this. Till then, keep learning.